I've thought for some time that you know, the idea behind some of these different cryptozoological creatures, whether we're talking about Bigfoot or Nessie, that you, there again, you have people who are reputable people who say that they're seeing a certain kind of definitive phenomenon, and yet, you know, we go down inside the Loch Ness and we put these submarines down there with cameras, and sometimes we get shadows, but we can't ever really capture these things, and it almost does appear as if they are moving in and out of some type of a portal or a gateway, an opening. They're coming in and taking snapshots of us, if you will, and then they're leaving back through these same openings, and it is simply a technology that is beyond our grasp. It's beyond our understanding. It's certainly beyond our capture. And so that many of the things that are even in modern mythology, like Bigfoot, notwithstanding the hoax that was perpetrated on all of us just recently, that there could be something that really is there. It really is real, and it has the ability to be able to manifest itself when it wants to, and sometimes it is seen by persons of reputable stature, and then all of a sudden it's gone. We get trace evidence. I mean, we get when UFOs appear, sometimes we get radiation among the crops. We get crop circles. We get scoop marks in persons, or we get the appearance of a Bigfoot. It's there. We might be able to collect one piece of hair or something that doesn't seem to match any kind of known species. Then all of a sudden it's gone again, like it's coming in and out of some slit in the fabric of our own reality.
Okay, let's go to Kevin in Tempe, Arizona, west of the Rockies. Hey, Kevin.
Oh, yeah, thank you, George. Tom, it's
sure
always
thing.
A pleasure. Wonderful show. I wondered, Tom, if you had ever heard of the gate that was found on an archaeological dig by the OSIR.
The OSIR? Tell me about it.
Well, it's Office of Scientific Investigation and Research, and they found a gate that they electrified, and it was actually a covert operation inside the OSIR, and what happened was that the entire division that was investigating this gate disappeared, and then they had to send in a team to find out what happened to them, and they found these empty offices and this electrified gate. And it was quite different.
Yeah, you know, I think I heard something about this, and it's very reminiscent of a question that George had asked me earlier about, you know, about why we're in Iraq. And I would just say that there is the possibility that you have not just sometimes metaphysical. You may have something that's actually a construct, something that was made but built by an intelligence that is not our own. And you know, I would tell people to remember that Saddam Hussein, he thought that he was the resurrected Nebuchadnezzar. Well, beyond all that, he had spent $500 million not only just rebuilding Babylon, but doing archaeological digs, recovery of artifacts, some that the general public has never known anything about. And when our military went into Iraq, it's interesting that one of the very first places they went was to the ancient location of the Tower of Babel and set up a military presence there. This is extraordinary that we would do something like that. Because it wasn't really a strategic placement for us, but for whatever reason, we had an interest in being there. And so it might have been that, like in this case that you're talking about, that there simply was something that was there that we had an interest in taking possession of.
Okay, let's go to Eric in Milwaukee, Wisconsin. Go ahead, Eric.
Hi, good morning, George and Tom.
Morning.
Very uncanny. I was just going to be telling you guys that I do believe there is a buried Stargate in Iraq, and in fact, I've read some stuff on the internet. First off, let me say I am a first-wave indigo adult, and And I just wanted to do a quick shout-out to all the others out there like me that are in the process of waking up. You're not the only one, so don't think by any means you're weird or anything. Something is happening, and all you got to do is ride the waves and pick up those good vibrations like the Beach Boys were talking about, and everybody should be fine. I did want to say, however, about the Giants that Tom was talking about earlier. Are you, George and Tom, aware that they in Saudi Arabia were digging for oil and came across two or more 30-foot-tall human-like remains?
Yeah, Steve Quayle was telling us about that.
Yeah, and I'll tell you what. I've actually seen the pictures of them on the internet, and, you know, one thing kind of leads you to another. I was reading about that, which leads you to the Anunnaki, which leads you to the lizards and the government and all of that stuff. It's kind of neat how I've kind of known all of this my whole life, and it's just kind of funny because they always said, shut up, you're the kid, you don't know anything. And I was reading out of newspapers my mom was telling me before I was in kindergarten, so... You know, here I've been my whole life fighting for all this stuff, fighting for the truth, you might say. And, Tom, I think you're definitely onto something there when you're saying the religion that we were taught is not the religion that was true. God wasn't telling us, they were telling us. And spiritualistic-wise, with me, too, I'm still a firm believer with the angels and God and all of that, just not the God that they were pushing on everybody. So I think the Stargate in Iraq and these 30-foot-tall remains, you know, they're onto something here, guys.
Well, you know, Tom, Goliath was one of these.
Yes, that's absolutely right. He was one of the offspring. Of the Watchers, and was an avowed enemy in the biblical text, of course, of Israel, and was defeated by David. And one thing that I would add, or maybe correct or add, is that I have never abandoned any of my ideas about God or what any of this means, other than to say that I also believe that there are things that none of us can definitively state as to what this phenomenon, what it means, and for instance, alien abduction. And, you know, even in my book, Nephilim Stargates, I have a little tiny space in there that I call Heiser's Lion. Because, you know, in long conversations with Michael Heiser, whose scholarship I don't think can be disputed.
No, not at all.
By anybody. He's a terrific mind. He can interpret seven extinct languages. He wrote his PhD in most of what we're talking about tonight. He's a brilliant guy, but he's also a very devout Christian. And I've asked him about some of this and about what alien abduction even means. And, you know, he has views that are certainly outside of what most traditional Christians would interpret the ET or the abduction phenomenon as being. And one of those, in my book, I subscribed as being Heiser's Lion, in which he talks about how these could be intelligences that are very intelligent, but they have nothing to do with the redemption process, in that they are not fallen. There might be something more similar to what the Vatican's been talking about lately, but that these are intelligences that they may view us and do things with us that, in our opinion, appear to be malevolent because it may be experimental or whatever. And so there's just a great deal to all of this, but I would not want anybody to think that I've abandoned any of my traditional beliefs, because I haven't.
Okay, let's go to who's next. Bradley in Nashville, Tennessee. Hey, Bradley.
Hi, how you doing, Tom?
We're great,
I have a question for you.
Sure.
Supposedly, the scriptures in the Bible say that the angel Gabriel spoke to Jesus, and then about 200 years later, he spoke to Muhammad. Now, we know what's going on for the past 2,000 years with the wars between Judaism, Christianity, and Islam, do you think Gabriel could have been a Nephilim that tinkered in human affairs?
Well, what you're talking about is not in the Bible. It might be in text outside of the Bible. And in any